It takes more than one person to assist in a personal injury claim. I am attorney Glenn Westmoreland, and we have a strong team at the Mack Law Firm. It is our goal to make sure your injury is properly attended to. Contact me at tangylawteam.com and let us get you the help you need.
Well, anyways, without further ado, we'll be introducing our speaker for today, Mr. Tom Tolar.
So anyway, back to the halfpenny sales tax. You know, we understand that taxes are not popular, but we needed that to stay competitive. The biggest problem that we had in the school system was keeping help. Everybody in here in business understands how hard that is right now. Well, staying competitive against Livingston Parish, St. Helena, St. Tammany, it was getting difficult, to say the least. So being able to give a 7% pay raise to all of our employees keeps us competitive against St. Tammany, Livingston, all our surrounding parishes. It puts us at the top of the list, matter of fact, right there with St. Tammany. We didn't beat St. Tammany, but we're ahead of Livingston Parish and St. Helena. So we're able to draw better teachers and retain teachers that we have here in Tensville Parish, which is critical. Also, the same thing goes for our food service personnel, our janitors, our bus drivers. You know, just go see how much food service personnel make, and you'll realize how hard it is for us to keep good people working in our schools. So we were, not only did we do the 7% increase for those employees, but we also did some stipend increases to try to bring those numbers a little higher, to try to get those more competitive. Because like I said, with everybody in business, you understand how hard it is to keep good help. Same thing we went through when we worked our stipends for our coaches. You know, a lot of people don't understand it. When you see coaches on the football field or on the baseball field, track coaches, cheerleader sponsors, they get paid a little extra. And when I say little, I mean a little extra. So we've been working trying to get those stipends up a little bit, because just imagine the hours that a football or a baseball coach puts in during the year. Without those employees doing that after school, we wouldn't be able to have those programs. So we're trying to raise those up. We just finished our summer school program, which is a big success this year. We had over 2,000 students, which is unheard of. We really pushed it this year. You know, we changed the name to Summer Camp, which made it sound a little more appealing for kids. But as you all are aware, with COVID and with virtual learning, and we lost a lot of headway with our students. Trying to get that headway back was our goal in trying to encourage people to come to summer school and try to close that gap. With over 2,000 students, that's, you know, 10% of our student population came for summer for 4 weeks to work with our teachers to reinforce what they had learned last year to close that gap. We had a meeting just this last week, and we talked, or this week, and we talked a lot about summer school moving forward. And we see that something that's going to continue to grow. And, you know, as most of you remember, summer school was always a punishment. If you didn't do good in school, you had to go to summer school. And nobody wanted to go to summer school. And if you went to summer school, you could have been picked at or looked at differently because you were having to go to summer school. Summer school's not that way now. We're turning the curve on that. And because they introduced more STEM things, which is the science, technology, engineering, the math, all the different things that kids like to do, plus they played more, they were in doing more activities, all of that associated with learning, trying to encourage kids to come. And what happened was, as soon as the kids started going, the first week we had more people wanting to come and more kids, because they found out that, hey, this is not as bad as it thought. You know, they thought that they were going to go in there and stick their head in a book all day, and so it turned into more of a summer camp type of atmosphere, which if we can continue to grow that, that will be great for our school system, because it helps, you know. Stacy, my wife, is a teacher, and she'll tell you that, you know, they spend the first couple weeks of school just trying to get kids back in that routine, because they have forgotten everything that they learned last year, and they've got to remind them and get them reacclimated back to the school system. But hats off to the school system for doing that. Also, the bus drivers. You know, we did transportation. We went and picked up these kids and brought them to school. The food services, we fed them every day. Everything that goes on during the regular school year, we had to do that during the summer. So a lot of people had to step up and do that. Update on the mask, because I know I'm going to get a question on that. We don't know. Right now, there is no mask mandate for inside the classroom or at the school campuses. There is a presidential executive order for mask public transportation, you have to wear a mask. So our school buses fall under that category as far as public transportation, so kids will have to wear a mask on our school buses. The school buses will be at full capacity, so wearing a mask is not a bad idea on a school bus. Everything that can be done at the school will still be done as far as social distancing and trying to spread things out and trying to keep numbers down, but learning has to go on. But I say all that to say that that's according to today. And if you watch the news or you know anything about what's going on with the medical field, COVID numbers are on the rise again. I would assume that we will be getting more directives from the state. And we spent a lot of time at the meeting this week talking about that. A lot of people think that it's just what we decide and what we want to do. And if you go to social media to get your information, everybody will tell you that we're the ones making the policies. We're the ones having to follow the guidelines from the state. And the state following the guidelines from the CDC. And everybody down the chain tells us what we have to do. So our hands are really tied when it comes to that. We can't step out from their guidance and say, well, we're going to refuse to accept the state health department guidelines. Because as you know, Billy's not here to give me a legal advice, but if we refuse to accept their advice and we go against their advice, then we're taking the liability of that, which we cannot afford to do. So I just encourage the parents and the teachers and the students to be flexible with this, because mask mandates will more than likely change in the next couple weeks. I hope it doesn't. I hope it stays just like it is, and I hope the numbers dramatically go back down. But probably not. So we'll see how that goes. Another item that we introduced at our meeting the other night, and I encourage you to go to our website and look at it. It's really pretty neat. It's a school bus that's been converted over the last year and a half, or almost 2 years now. It's called the Streamliner. Streamliner. And it's a brainchild of our superintendent and her staff. They wanted to take some of the educational things out into the community, out to fairs and festivals, out to different events. So they took a bus, I believe his name was Mr. Bill Ford, retired bus driver. He donated his school bus back to the school system. And we took the school bus and we sent it down to Kent Mitchell, and Wayne Mitchell and them just totally gutted the bus, redid it, serviced everything that could be serviced. We sent it to Berryland down in Ponchatoula, where a printing company came in and did a wrap on the entire bus. And the whole idea is that STREAM is a science, technology, the reading, all the different aspects, engineering, art, all of these things are going to be loaded in this bus, where kids, it'll be handicapped accessible as well, but kids will be able to come through this bus at a fair, festival, at their school or wherever. They'll have hands-on things to do in this bus. It's kind of like the old-fashioned bookmobile that we used to have. It's something similar to that. They added air conditioners to it, generator to it. The sponsor list, and I can't name all of them because I'd leave some of them out, but First Guaranty Bank obviously is one of the big sponsors of the bus, as well as Kent Mitchell and Entergy and some of those things like that. But on the bus, you'll see, if you go to the website, you'll see the sponsors and the ads on the side of the bus to help promote the bus itself. So in the future, when events are coming up in this area, we need to reach out to the school and get that bus up here, because it'll be interactive for the kids to play with. Also, a little plug for Independence. Independence Shop did a lot of the work with their cabinets and stuff inside, making the inside of the bus work right. Another big item that you may have heard of is we purchased, in the process of purchasing, 40 acres of land adjacent to our property in LaRonger. If you've ever been through LaRonger, and my district itself covers mainly the Kentwood and Sumner school area, but I also go all the way down to Cranky Corners by Folsom. So some of my district includes the LaRonger area. But regardless, anybody with half a knowledge of Tangipahoa Parish understands where the major growth has been in our parish. And it's been from that LaRonger, the Bidico, Ponchatoula, that area. And we all know that that's continuing to move further north. And we'll have these problems with population growth and with school problems, with trying to fit people in our schools. We'll have these problems in 10, 20 years, there's no doubt. But right now we have issues on the south end with our schools, and we have phase one projects, which I'll get into a little bit, but we have phase one projects where we're adding classrooms to our southern schools to try to compensate for some of the growth. But LaRonja campus, if you've ever been through there, it's elementary, middle school, and a high school at one campus. The only school that we have like that. And it is so crowded on that campus. High schoolers have to walk through the elementary area, and elementary kids have to walk through the high school areas, and it's just a recipe for disaster. The traffic around that school is atrocious. We're gonna have to do something in the future with LaRonja to, if nothing else, handle the growth south of the parish, push some of those students further north to a bigger school. But anyway, that's a long ways around to say that buying 40 acres connecting to our current campus was a big win for us through the help with the parish council. The parish council helped us work out a deal, and of course we can only pay appraised value. But we got it appraised and we paid the appraised value. So that's gonna be a big win for us because that gives us some growth. I hope we have the same issues up here one day as far as having to enlarge our schools too, but it's coming. But that was a good find, and hopefully that'll alleviate. In the future, maybe we'll see a new school there at LaRonja to replace what has got to be one of our oldest campuses. In the phase one project, and I did mention phase one projects are coming up right now, and that was the initial. There's several different phases of growth that we're gonna do, but the phase one was the immediate problems that we needed to face in the Champ Cooper area, the Ponchatoula area. We have subdivisions that are going up right now that will have kids living in these houses where we don't have a school for these kids to go to. That's a problem. You know, I get calls from parents up here about the AC in the gym not working or not having an AC in the gym, and I get calls for the driveway at Sumner Middle is not adequate. We have issues up here, but we don't have issues to the point where we don't have a room to put a kid. And those are issues that we're gonna have to face, whether it's with the new school or continuing to enlarge. But in phase one, part of phase one for the north end was Kentwood High School, one of our oldest buildings and beautiful building. The windows itself, if you go look at them, the wood windows need some work. When the architects first started talking to us about replacing the windows at Kentwood, and the numbers came up to what they came up to, I just about lost it because I couldn't imagine it costing that much money. But it's not just a matter of just popping windows out and putting windows back in. You have a lot of woodwork, a lot of millwork to do to replace the windows at Kentwood. We were scheduled to do that before school started this year. That didn't happen. With COVID and with suppliers, we just couldn't get a guarantee that we could get all the windows delivered in time to get them installed. So the money is there for that project, and that will happen before school starts next year. We'll go out on bids and we'll start that process where they'll start working on it. Because we want to get that work done during the summer, obviously, because we don't want to interrupt school in the high school itself. But the other part of phase one was to pay off Sumner debt. For those of us that live in the Sumner School District, we have been paying for 30 some odd years a property tax to build Sumner High School and then the middle school, and then to remodel Chest Road and remodel Spring Creek. The property owner stepped up and said, hey, look, we'll pay for this, we want this, and we did. But we still had a little bit left to owe on that, and as we were moving forward as a parish, it's hard to go down there and fight for things whenever when our constituents, the people that vote for me, they're paying a property tax for their school. And then you have other schools that are arguing and hollering for a field house or whatever the argument is of the day. We're paying property taxes, they're not paying property taxes in the cost. So we wanted that even across the board. Nobody paying property taxes, additional property taxes for their individual districts. That's not a way to fund anything moving forward. Now it's going to be parish-wide funding moving forward on projects that we see necessary from the top of the parish to the bottom of the parish. So that was a big win for our area to wipe the slate clean on that. Of course, we added the half-cent sales tax, but everybody spoke out loudly for that because sales tax people pay that from one end of the parish to the other end of the parish. That also promotes more sales within our parish because as people spend more money here in the parish, obviously it goes right back into our coffers. And didn't clear that up, but I want to make sure to say that. Every bit of that half cent sales tax will go to pay raises the 7% for employees. It's got to. Well, it does not get sucked into the court system. It doesn't get sucked into litigation. It doesn't get sucked into general fund. It goes strictly to pay raises. So as Bruce could tell us right now, sales taxes have been on the rise for the last probably year or so. And we've really been reaping the benefit of those sales tax increases. But with inflation coming, I don't know if that's going to hold true or not. But regardless, whatever we collect on that half penny will go to our employees in Tangipahoa Parish School System, which is a great reward for their hard work. Let's see. Last but not least, talked about the Kentwood windows. A couple of little things that we did for Kentwood just recently was forgiving the debt for baseball and the band. You know, Kentwood started a baseball program and won state. I mean, Kentwood's done great. And it's the only school in this parish that doesn't have a baseball field. They have to go somewhere else to play all their games. The same thing with track. It is amazing that, you know, they go to state and they win state with track and they don't have a track facility. So they borrowed some money from the school system to get their band equipment and to get their startup equipment for their baseball program several years ago, and they've been paying it back, but we wiped that debt clean because of COVID and games and different things that they couldn't raise the money to pay back. So that's something that we put back into the local thing. We have a rally set up for August the 6th, a back to school rally where we're going to meet all our new teachers. All the schools will attend, all the teachers will attend. We did that 2 years ago, and last year we were not able to do it because of COVID, but hopefully we're going to be able to do it this year. It's a big morale booster where we bring in guest speakers to pump up the teachers and give them some school spirit and get them kicked off on the right start. And then as far as school starts, August 11th and 12th, it'll be a soft start where half the kids will go on the 11th, the other half of the kids will go on the 12th, just to give everybody a chance to transition. We did that this last year, and it was a great way. The teachers really appreciate it because you're not getting just inundated. Desegregation case, we have a consent agreement with the plaintiffs. The judge has signed it, and we're in a, I don't know exactly where we fall in the, like a 3-year oversight where basically the court's gonna just continue to get reports for a 3-year period to make sure that we're doing what we said we were gonna do and everybody's still happy. And we are. We are doing to the letter everything that we agreed to in the consent agreement. And we have people to watch that every day and departments to watch that every day. So we're hoping that at the end of that window, of course, getting the judge's signature on it is a big deal. That was a huge win for Tangipahoa Parish. The next step is just to see that through and then hopefully be out completely under their watch. Hiring procedures are set in stone as far as how, you know, where do we go, where do we try to recruit our new employees. Also, the process that we go through for interviewing and selecting administrators, all of those things, you know, set up with a panel where we have two white, two black, you know, it's everything is set up for equality. And all those checks and balances are put into place. Also, they keep track of the number, racial breakdown of employees throughout the school system, throughout administration. But all these things, there's nothing new. There's nothing new that we've agreed to get the judge to sign this. But the judge just finally had confidence in the fact that we were doing what we said we were going to do in the original agreement, which is what we've been doing for years. Personally, my desired outcome is for us to get out of overwatch from the federal court system so that we can educate. But what we want as a system, and I can't speak for the entire system, but I can just speak for myself, is we want the best quality people in every position possible, regardless, race, gender, whatever. We want the best quality people teaching our kids. And for me, it just seems like the court gets in the way of us getting that sometimes. But as long as the court sees that we're still putting those efforts in place, where we're trying to hire, promote, and keep the best people in the right positions, then there should be no problems. Okay. And then also all the different processes that are in place that if someone feels discriminated against, there is a well-defined process for them and an apartment for them to go to make their claim, for it to be investigated, for it to be corrected, or move forward with that. So
it's time to celebrate. I'm the 2021 Young Women of Excellence Award recipient, Anne-Marie LaCour, and I'm inviting you to the Tangipahoa Parish Summer Reading Program's Awards Day parties. Head on over to your local branch for a party full of games, prizes, refreshments, and you'll even receive a free book. Go to tangilibrary.com for more information. I'll see you this summer in the library.